So I said, well,
generous hand.
I'll do my best. Well, I think that before we go into business, I have to, for those who don't know the region very well, give a brief outline, okay? So I want to mention that South America is basically a continent or a subcontinent. We have a population of over 400 million people, and the good news is that Brazil, which accounts for half of it, for 200 million, and Argentina, almost 50 million, so there we have like 60% of the region, are doing much better economically now. Brazil had their problems, and they're still having them, but I think that shortly, probably by the end of this year, they will end with a recession. Argentina has done tremendous changes and is improving strongly. So I think that is quite good news for the cruise lines and for all the business, no? But I want to say something about the region. I think we are an undiscovered region. And more important than everything is, and not many people know that we have so much, but so much history there. You know, when the president of the FCCA was talking about the Caribbean, you know, I was listening with a lot of attention, and I was very proud because many of the things that she said, we have them in our region too. I mean, and just to mention a few, I mean, untouched nature, deserts. I mean, deserts in Chile, you have the driest desert on earth. You have glaciers. I mean, nothing better than having a scotch with a piece of ice that they've just brought down, I mean, from the Zodiac. You know, they go and pick it up and they give you a scotch with that ice. Nothing better than that. Probably two of those. You know, one I think is not enough. Okay. Then we have the Amazon River, you know, in Peru, in Brazil we have it. You know, and one of the things that the cruise lines love, and also the passengers, is the World Heritage Sites of UNESCO. I mean, just to mention a couple, I mean, we have Machu Picchu in Peru, Cartagena de Indias in Colombia, a beautiful place, but more related to the Caribbean than to the other part of South America. We have the city of Valparaíso in Chile. I mean, I can go on for ages here. Just I'll mention those two. You have special things like, you know, navigate the Strait of Magellan, go through Cape Horn. I mean, before the Panama Canal was constructed, everybody had to go through the Strait of Magellan, and it's history. It's nice, no? Then we have in the Patagonia, in Argentina, in Chile, we have the fantastic fauna of Ecuador with the turtles. They are in and iguanas in the Galapagos. We have the Brazilian, the Rio de Janeiro Carnival, which just to mention it, you know, you feel like dancing, you know, and the elegance of Buenos Aires. You know, these are super places with a lot of history, a lot of things to do. Probably some of you have never heard of Colonia. It's a beautiful city, also World Heritage Site in Uruguay. It's a 1 hour drive from Montevideo. It's a beautiful place. I was there, I think it was last November. I mean, if you have an opportunity of going there, make use of it because it's a great place. And now, another thing that is very special to our region is the Antarctic. Because we have two countries that have direct access to the Antarctic. We have Argentina, we have Chile. We have Ushuaia in Argentina, we have Punta Arenas, and and Puerto Williams in Chile. And I don't know how this is going to develop, but one might be an interesting news that I can present now is that I read not that long ago that Chile is contemplating building a dock in the Antarctic. You know, I don't know how big, I don't know the details, but it will be nearby the actual most important base, the Frey base in the Antarctic, and the idea was to have it ready by 2020. So I think if that is done, might be that will give another impulse to tourism in that region. Another important part of Latin America, South America, is that we have very, very, very good airlines that fly daily to the Europe, to the States, everywhere. So that is something not minor for us. Now, what are our strengths? We don't have terrorism. Our security is quite good. Logistics. I think that both to the cruise ships, both to the passengers, is world class. I think our supplies of vegetables, of wines. You know, you have the beautiful wines, the Malbec from Argentina, the Carmenere from Chile. You have the bananas from Ecuador, all the tropical fruits from Brazil. Excuse me, but I represent everybody, so you know I have to say, mention things of every country. So I think that is something good we have, and which are basically products that are well known. Now, we South America are different than the Caribbean. We are more of an exploration route. But when I say exploration, I again want to mention it with history, because I think that is important and people want to see that. People are interested in history. Today, these new routes, these new places that are not full of cement, people want to see. It is a tendency in the world, and it's not new now. I mean, it's been going on for quite some time. We have the Inca culture, you know, with Machu Picchu, which is well known everywhere. We have the Easter Island with its moais that nobody knows where they came from. Some think that they are ETs or whatever. We have the Robinson Island, Crusoe. And we have the Chinchorro Mummies. May I ask everybody here, who knows what the Chinchorro Mummies are? Well, not Chileans or... not the Chileans. Okay, I am very proud to say that I am the ambassador for the world of the Chinchorro culture.
I live in Argentina and I don't know what is the Chinchorro culture,
Sebastian. Because you should read more. Not my problem, you have bad schools there. Okay, no, this is... let me take a minute for this, because I'm so proud of what I'm doing.
You can take 30 seconds, because we want to have a little discussion.
No, the Chinchorro culture. Imagine in Arica, I was the vice president of the board of the Port of Arica, and I was just as ignorant as that guy there, until I got there.
Hello, one.
I was just as ignorant, and then I discovered this, and I said, how come me as a Chilean, I had never heard of it? And then I started asking all my colleagues. None of them knew. And I started spreading the word. And we are now in the process of converting the Chinchorro culture into World Heritage by UNESCO. We are in the process of that. And let me say something. I mean, they are 3,000 years older than Tutankhamun. So it's quite something which not many people know, and it's interesting, and they have very, very good museums in Arica. So, you know, we're also a route like Alaska, the south, with the glaciers, you know, everything. But we have live volcanoes, we have history. Now, what is our problem? My humble opinion is that the routes in South America are very long, leaving away a bit the Colombia, because Colombia again is more related that part to the Caribbean, because on the Pacific Ocean they have very little business. But I think they're very long, because we can summarize by saying we have 15-day routes. Okay. Proposals. I mean, what do we think that should be the our goal? Where we should go for the future? All countries in Latin America are having meetings now, trying to generate a closer relationship, help each other. Just to mention a few, I mean, Not that long ago, the director of the Port of Buenos Aires visited Valparaíso and tried to make an association. Uruguay, I think it was November last year, made an association with CLIA in Brazil. And Uruguay is having every year a very, very, very good seminar about the cruise industry. And if anybody wants to go, I mean, it's, I think, a constructive place, and they're doing a lot of things. You know, I congratulate them for that. Then the routes, in the routes, you have investments now of the new terminal in Valparaíso, $9 million investment. That same group now has the concession of the Manta port in Ecuador. I think it is about $1 million. Okay? Again, when I mentioned the good things about the change in government in Argentina, I think it was, you know, a couple of months when they got in, they got together with all the cruise industry, and they asked, what are the problems? And there were five major problems that they were mentioning, and they were immediately resolved. So things are being done, but I think that if there's not a closer collaboration, or I don't know, however we want to call it, with the cruise lines, it is very difficult. Because I think personally that people like the terminal in Valparaíso have guts to invest $9 million in a terminal that they get around 40 calls a year. It's difficult like that. So if there was a relationship where things say, well, we're not asking for money, we're asking for ideas, we're asking for collaboration. Because if you tell me, well, Sebastian, if you do this, I can do that. Can you help me? I know, for example, Uruguay is working now on liberating the casinos too in Montevideo. I think Colombia too is doing some working on that. But again, their own initiatives, and I think we should work together. Okay? Now, to finalize, I think the biggest problem we have is that we have our routes are very, very, very long. 90% of the market, for what I understand, is of 7 days or less. So what happens? We only have that of 15. So we are losing 90% of the market. So the proposal, I think, is that all the countries make an effort, but again, together with the cruise lines, to say, okay, if you guys liberate cabotage, we can do this, this, or that. Incentivate too. Because I have played an active role in trying to release cabotage in Chile for passengers. It is not easy. Because most people, they try to associate it with cargo. And when you talk about cargo, then you're in trouble. Okay? So I think that if joint efforts were made with strong proposals, again, no money involved. I mean, I'm asking for the ideas on, you know, what to do. Show us the way, and I think we can do much more. So basically, that is what I have to say. I think the future is good for all of us. As I said, as I started, the two most important countries of the region, Brazil and Argentina, are starting to improve, and we need your help. We need your help, and I'm sure that 2%, a little bit more participation we have, can be increased tremendously. And again, thank you very much for everybody's time. And I would like to finalize with the most difficult part, because Anne asked me to put what was the threat of South America. And that was the best I could come up with. So I want to warn everybody that if you visit us and if you fall in love with the region, with the girls, with the wine, and all, you do it under your own risk. Okay? Thank you very much to everybody.
Okay, I think we're going to have a very abbreviated discussion period here, but I'd love to get your reaction. Mark, if I could maybe go to you first.
You know, we're big in South America because we're in the expedition business, and it's a great business. And he's hit on all the points and the challenges. The, There's a great domestic cruise business there that we could all tap into, which is always great to go into a place and have source customers. I think the biggest issues are some of the regulations, rules, and to a certain extent, not as, I shouldn't say this, but I will, prevalent as it used to be, some corruption issues, you know, so to get things done is just so difficult. And particularly the cabotage rules. I mean, you know, right now if you sail from, I have around South America cruises, once I get to Rio, if I want to go to Manaus, I have to, and then down, up, back up to Florida, I have to run a 24, 25-day cruise, where if I could segment it in Manaus, I could run two 14-day cruises, and they'd be easier to sell. But because I have to run a 25-day cruise, I actually move into a totally different demographic of my customer. It starts looking at more like my World Cruise customer than my normal customer. So if there's one thing that could be addressed, would be the cabotage laws, and particularly in Brazil, because it is the biggest challenge. And we have a 10-day cruise that does great between Rio and Buenos Aires, or Buenos Aires and Rio, and then what happens is once you get to Rio, then what do? If you skip the Amazon, then you can do a 14-day cruise, but it's pretty much a Caribbean cruise. So if you want to do something that really shows off Brazil, you have to go up the Amazon, and then you add another 10 to 12 days to it. So for me, that would be the biggest thing. The points you made, airlift's great, both in Chile, you know, and in Argentina has gotten a lot better. The charter availability for flights down to Ushuaia has been great. So overall, it's a great destination. It's on, you know, we operate year-round in Peru, so at the Galapagos, so we know about regulations and things like that. But it's been very cooperative relationship that we have there, and the ship's full, and they've managed the Galapagos very well, I have to say. Some of the regulations are painful, but that's why they've managed Galapagos very well. But I think if there could be a partnership between the governments, and I understand they're trying to protect jobs and things like that, but particularly on the cabotage issue in Brazil is probably the biggest single issue we face.
Claudius?
Totally agree with every single comment Mark made about Brazil, and I want to leave it at that and not belabor it. I think a lot of us would love to sell 7-night cruises in South America, but just talking about Chile, for example, I think it'd be very difficult to sell a round-trip 7-night Chile cruise for a couple of reasons. First of all, travel time from North America down to Santiago, then transfer to Valparaiso, and then the cost involved and the time for a 7-night cruise, I think it'd be very tough. Maybe my colleagues disagree. But so that's one issue. And then I also want to talk about also on the west coast of South America, and some of it is true also for some of the Brazilian ports, is that the quality of guides and transport is really lacking to have a quality experience. And then the other thing I think I want to mention is that a lot of the ports, as long as you're going on a shore excursion, you're in pretty good shape. But for a lot of the independent passengers, when you go ashore in some of the ports, particularly in the west side of South America, it is not a pleasant experience. So that would be my comments.
Camille, I'd like to ask you, you're the person who's selling these cruises. What are the challenges of selling to South America? Or is it an easy sell?
I mean, we do sell it. We've had success with our, we have, you know, the 15-day itinerary. We have a 20-day itinerary. And it's been pretty successful. But it is, you know, our market is we sell a lot of 7-day itineraries. So that is a challenge. It's primarily an older demographic. And but it's, you know, it's a great demographic, and you know, we're having success with the cruises that we do have. It's all Norwegian Sun at this point, but we are doing well with it. And but it is a bit of a niche market, not our, you know, standard run of the mill customer. You know, it skews slightly older. They need more time.
I was just going to say, you know, the highest guest satisfaction rating that we have in our entire fleet is the Galapagos on the 7-day program, which was a 9-day program, because we combine it with a land before and after and a flight down, so in a charter flight over the Galapagos. So there just tells you there's a deliverable there that delivers it at wows, and it's on everybody's bucket list, as is Antarctica too. I mean, nobody comes back from Antarctica. They may talk a little bit about the Drake Passage, but nobody comes back from Antarctica that isn't thrilled. Because I guess if they weren't interested enough, they wouldn't have worked so hard to get there, because it is a schlep. So
I do think it's an opportunity for millennials, because we are seeing, you know, know, that is what millennials want. And so it could be interesting to try to market. They need to have the vacation time, though. Yeah.
You know, so. But you know, if you think about it, you can do a great, instead of a Panama Canal cruise from Fort Lauderdale to L.A. in 15 or 16 days, you can do a nice 14 day to Callao, or maybe a 16 day to Valparaiso, and it's interesting because you don't get into all the cabotage laws issues, so you can actually visit more Caribbean ports and things like that. So there are some huge opportunities on that coast, and of course the great thing is when you do. You know, we sell a lot of Machu Picchu together with the Galapagos. We sell a lot of Machu Picchu together with that first leg of the Route South America cruise that's, you know, 14, 16 days in length. So there's a lot to, like you said, there's it has almost everything. The distances, it's like Asia, same thing in Asia. The distances between the ports are pretty far. And also the distances for at least the North American market to get there is expensive and pretty far. The market can easily support, you know, 14, 16-day cruises, but it is going to be somewhat seasonable, and it is an older demographic just because of the price point. So. Now, by the way, the Galapagos isn't. The Galapagos average age is 10 years younger than the average age of the rest of our fleet, so because it is the millennials, it is the people looking to hit their first bucket list place. So.
And I think the other advantage for the Galapagos is you don't have to involve an overnight flight there like you do to Santiago or to Buenos Aires or Rio de Janeiro. It's, you know, 4 or 5 hours from Miami, and it's
actually the biggest problem we have is they fly domestic planes there, and there's not enough business and first class seats. If somebody flew a real plane with a real first or business class routing into there, we'd fill the business class every Saturday. So.
Interesting. Well, we.
May I ask a question?
Okay.
But what you are talking about the shorter routes? If I ask you. And what happens if I say, for example, having as home port Punta Arenas, going to Ushuaia, Puerto Madryn, and see the world, the whales, going to the Falkland Islands, or let's say out of Valparaiso, going to Robinson Crusoe Island, then down to Puerto Montt, Chacabuco, and back again to Valparaiso. Those are all 7 days, and or go to from Valparaiso to Machu Picchu and back. I mean, there you have plenty of new.
I think if you talk about 7 day cruising with the distance, and North Americans are making a big investment to fly down there, it would have to be 7 days plus land excursions. Anyway, that's what we do in Alaska, right? It's all those cruises that go across the Gulf, the majority of those folks are taking a longer trip. And I mean, and considering that for sort of the bucket list destinations, because you've got, you know, pre-post in Atacama, and you can go lots of different places from a 7 day cruise, but you have to make the cabotage easier, and you have to let the itinerary planners go crazy. What's the best 7 days along the shore I can do? And then start to think about, okay, now I want to get the folks off and have them go inland to some great places. And then you start to, because tour operators would be attracted to that sort of a cruise product, we find ways to, you know, to push it into selling more easily. So.
And by the way, 10-day, 14-day cruises are still okay because you're amortizing your air costs. That's the issue about length of cruise is the reason we're predominantly seven is that the market's much broader because there's no air element for a third, you know, out of North America. You know, how many, half your customers drive there? For us, when I look at a short cruise, if you're trying to amortize, like Asia cruises, my planners want to do 9-day cruises all the time, and I said, well, don't expect North Americans on them because nobody's going to fly, you know, to Hong Kong for a 9-day trip, even if they take a 3 or 4 or 6 day land program. And by the way, if I sell 9-day cruises versus 15-day cruises, I got to sell 1/3 more, almost twice as many customers. So I think 10 and 14-day cruises are doable. I think the issues are some of the cabotage issues. And by the way, everybody's pretty welcoming. I mean, people enjoy the experience in Latin America, so in South America. So I think we're fine. To me, is regulations, because every country. I hate to keep talking about Brazil. I'll probably be banned from there in the future. But not only do you have cabotage, but you also have every port kind of reads the because every state's different. They read the rules, the national rules, separately. So I'll call in one port and I come to the next port, not recently, please. and get in trouble because we follow the same rules we followed in the same port. So there's a lot of that stuff that could be, if it could be worked out, it would be good business for everyone. Now, they have a domestic cruise business that they're trying to protect, and it ebbs and flows, as you know, so that's the reason for it. But do you do it for seasonal? How do you make it work so everybody wins? That's the end of the day. And nobody's figured that out yet.
I really hate to cut off our discussion because it's so interesting, but I think we've got to call it a day now. I would like to thank all of our destination experts, Carmen, Amy, Sebastian. Thank you very much.